now we'll go ahead and we'll share the desktop here. And we're going to talk about how to access Responseware from within TurningPoint first. And then after we talk about TurningPoint, we'll jump over to TurningPoint Anywhere to talk about the accessibility from within there. So obviously Responseware will permit students to use any web-enabled device to answer the questions. So that could be their cell phone, their laptop or PC, or anything else they may have. Now, there's going to be two different perspectives for this. The first perspective is what the instructor must do to enable a Responseware session. So let me first of all open up a presentation. And now that we have a presentation open, the next thing I'll do is go ahead and access Responseware by clicking on my Tools tab on the ribbon. And then from Tools, I'm going to scroll down to the third option from the bottom to where it reads Responseware. Now when I click on Responseware, it immediately wants me to put in my username and also my password. Now just below there, I have options for participants. Now if I keep it at Allow Guest, that means exactly as it says. That means that guests can go ahead and join my session. If I click on where it says Require Login, this means that students need to have their own personal Responseware license. Okay, so are you guys in a situation where you guys purchase Responseware licenses from the bookstore? Is that happening on campus?
Yep.
Okay. So this is probably what the instructors is going to click then. They're going to click Require Login. That way when the students log on to RWPoll, the website, they're going to have to put in their own personal code to go ahead and join a session. Now for my purposes, I'm going to keep it on Allow Guest. Now I also have an option down here at the bottom called Reserved Session ID, Reserved ID. Basically ahead of time, I could have reserved an ID. And basically what that means is that every time I run a Responseware session, my device, my session ID can be the same. Now if I don't put in any type of reserved session ID and I just log in, it's going to give me a random six-digit session ID, which I cannot predict. I have no idea what that's going to be. But if I reserve it ahead of time, it can be the same thing every single time that I run a Responseware session. Now, I just can't type out anything I want from here. I need to reserve this ahead of time through the RWPoll site. So for right now, I'm going to keep this blank. So once again, we log into Responseware. We put in our username and our password. Most of the time, those instructors are not going to allow guests. They're going to require a login. And if they set it up ahead of time, they could type out their reserved ID. Once they do this, they now want to click the login button that we have at the bottom middle. And this is going to take them to the Responseware session. Now, since I did not put in that custom ID, it's giving me this randomly generated six digit session ID number. So with this session ID number, this is what your students would need to go ahead and join the session. This is the only thing that I must do as the instructor. So I clicked on Tools, I went down to Responseware, I put in my user information, and I logged in. Since I didn't put in the reserve session ID, it's just giving me this random six-digit number. I'm always going to keep this number unless I click the logout button or lose internet connection. Now if I click logout and log back in, you're going to see it gives me a completely different session ID number. So that's why it's going to be extremely valuable if I can have a custom reserved session ID, because that way it can be the same every single time that I would run a Responseware session. And so, Jason, any questions at this time in terms of what the instructor needs to do to start a Responseware session?
No.
Okay. Now, from the student's point of view, I want you guys to actually do this. So if you don't have any type of smartphone, I want you to bring up a separate browser menu. And I want you to log on to the internet and go to the website rwpoll.com. That's rwpoll.com. And I'll give you guys an opportunity to do this. Keep me posted on your progress on this. So basically, students would log into the site, and immediately it's going to ask them to put in that session ID. Now, I have permitted guests to join. If I didn't permit guests to join this, then you're not going to be able to immediately put in the session ID. You're going to have to put in your user information in terms of your Responseware license code.
Is there some way I can exit WebEx to pull up a browser?
Yeah, you should be able to actually minimize the screen or hit the Escape tab possibly. Or what I can do is just go ahead and return to this meeting page. Okay.
No, just the Escape tab works.
Okay, very good.
So what do you want to do with the RW pool? Do you want to log into the session, enter a session ID, or do you want
yeah.
to...
I want you to go ahead and log into the session so that when you log into the session, you want to type in the session ID 282319. Now, have either one of you used this as a student?
Not this exact software.
Okay.
Yeah, I personally haven't used Responseware. I've used
Got
other years.
Very good. Well, the good thing about Responseware is that you could use it in a hybrid situation where some of the students have a clicker and then some of the other students have, you know, a smartphone or something web-enabled where they can join through Responseware. As long as they have their own personal site license, they can go ahead and do that. And as you guys see, once you put in the session ID, it's going to ask for the first and last name. This is a case where we can go ahead and track individual responses. So even if I'm an instructor who is using a participant list, if people join through Responseware, when I generate those individual reports, it's just going to put them at the tail end of the report. So I'm still going to be able to track everybody's individual responses. Now, when you get to that screen that says first name, last name, and user ID, those are not required fields, so you can actually skip right by it. But of course, if an instructor wants to track the individual responses, they're going to require that that information be filled out. Now, where it says user ID, a student could possibly put in their student ID if they want to be tracked by something other than their first and last name. That's not very commonly used, and remember, none of those fields are required. Okay, so at this time, have you guys logged in?
Yeah, I've logged in.
All right. So now what I'll do is go ahead and begin my presentation. Now, when I begin my presentation, you're, of course, not going to see any other slides but the turning points. You're not going to see any PowerPoint slides whatsoever because you can't view the presentation through Responseware. You're only going to be able to answer the questions through Responseware. Okay, so at this time, I can see that I have one response in the upper right-hand corner. So obviously, somebody responded to the question. Now, I also want you guys to notice on that Responseware page where you have the opportunity of putting in feedback. So go ahead and type me a message because you have that chance to do it. So this is a case where you can go ahead and ask the instructor a question if you need to or just give general feedback. Okay, now in the upper right-hand corner where I have pulling open, I can see that two people have sent me feedback. Now, to view the feedback, all I'm doing is clicking on the F11 key. And I can see that I have two questions in there. What is fall? And I enjoy warm weather. And I could type back, I enjoy hot weather, actually. Not cold weather or warm weather. I'm living in the wrong place. And I can send that back to you. I can either send it back to everybody, as you can see through all, or I can send it to a specific person. Okay, so it can be a private message as well. Now, you guys are going to see a little pop-up screen showing you that I sent the user feedback right back at you guys. Okay, so this is a case where you can go ahead and communicate with that instructor professor during the presentation. Now, when I shut down polling on a question, I'm, of course, going to see within my presentation, and you're also going to see it through the Responseware. And as soon as I go to the next question in the presentation, you're going to immediately see it pop up. There's no reason to refresh or anything like that. And at this time, you can go ahead and respond again. Okay, I can see I have two responses. I'll shut down the polling, and I'm going to go ahead and see the results now. Since you guys did put in your user information, when I'm done with the presentation, I could come down to my reports, and I can go ahead and generate some individual reports. So if I were using a participant list in conjunction with the Responseware, I'm going to have all of those people who are using one of the clickers, as well as everybody logging in through Responseware. All right, so when I generate the reports, now I'm going to see both of your names in the reports, or maybe not. I actually have to save first, which is one step that I did not take. So I need to save first. And the other thing I need to do is not run this on anonymous. That's a good lesson to learn right there. You can see in the upper right-hand corner how I have it on anonymous. If I had it on anonymous, I cannot identify the individual people. So all good lessons that eventually maybe your instructors might run into to your instructors run into that, they're going to be completely probably perplexed why they can't see any individuals, and that's because they are running their presentation on anonymous, and they were not either using a participant list or running it on auto. If you run it on auto, that basically means that we can pick up anybody logging in through Responseware, and we can also pick up device IDs. You guys with me so far?
Yep.
All right. That's all there is to it in terms of starting a Responseware session and also what the students must do to join a Responseware session. So the next thing I'm going to talk about is what the instructor must do if they want to go ahead and reserve a session ID. So if they want their session ID to be the same for every single class and every single time they use Responseware, they can reserve this ahead of time through the RW Pulse site. So that's where I'm going to go right now. So when I get to RW Poll, it's going to ask me for my username and my password, obviously. Eventually here. Okay, so I'm going to log in to my Responseware account. I'll click that. Put in my password. And now when I log in, it's going to say, of course, welcome to Responseware. And the first little link below is going to say, reserve or change your session ID. If I click this, I already have a reserved session ID. You see, it's H-O-L-T. If I want to change it, maybe put a Z on it like it should be, I can just go ahead and type it out, press OK, and now it's going to tell me I've successfully registered the session name. Now, if I go back to it, and let's say I want to register Kevin, and I know somebody else already has this. So I would log in, press OK, and it's going to tell me the session is already reserved because somebody else already has this session ID. So it's basically one instructor at a time for everybody who uses Responseware can have a particular session ID. Well, of course, Holtz is mine. As long as nobody took it within the past 30 seconds or so, I'm going to be able to get it back here. And there we go. Okay, so now I have it back. I thought I had it back. There we go. All right, so now I have the Holtz name back, and that is my session ID, which means anytime I log into Responseware, I can put this in as my reserve session ID. I don't have to keep on going back to RW Poll and reserving it every single time I use Responseware. It's a one-time thing. So now, when I'm back in here, go to Tools, Responseware, and I get to this main screen, once again, I have the option to allow guests or require login. Obviously, at your university, it's going to be require login. And now I can put in what I reserved as my session ID. Press login. No longer is it going to be a random six-digit number. I'm going to have Holtz in there, and I can use Holtz anytime I want. Now, I have to tell you a quick little story how somebody used this university. It was maybe the negative side of putting in a reserved session ID. The instructor actually put their session ID in their syllabus. And in their syllabus, they put in the certain days that they would be using that session ID. So, you know, Tuesday, October 5th. They put in there that they're going to be using Responseware, and here's going to be the session ID. So students knew that they get credit for answering the questions. Well, basically, this is internet-based. You can log in from whatever you want. The student just stayed at home, and they logged in the Responseware, and they answered the questions, and they still got credit for being in class. So that's really kind of an anomaly, but, of course, I mean, you guys know. I was a student. Any type of advantage I can take, I'm going to find it. And, you know, so that was one way in which you know, I don't recommend that the session ID is put into the syllabus, at least in terms of when exactly it's going to be used. All right, you guys have any questions on reserving that session ID or using it?
Nope.
All right, so let me now jump into Turning Point Anywhere, because in Turning Point Anywhere, you can also go ahead and use Responseware regardless what type of questions you're asking. All right, so I opened up Turning Point Anywhere. I'm now going to click my main menu drop-down. And just like in Turning Point, I'm going to go to my Tools tab and Responseware second from the bottom. When I click on Responseware, still need to put in my username and my password. Always helps. Click Remember Me. And now I have the option to go ahead and put in that reserve session ID, which I will. Also, it's important to note that if you have a reserve session ID, it's good for both Turning Point and Turning Point Anywhere. As I click login, it's now going to tell me welcome to the session. Now, if participants join my session and I'm not using any type of question list, and maybe I'm just doing verbal questions, or I'm running it over top of another application. Basically, this is what it looks like. Okay, so let me go ahead and cancel this and get back to the main screen here. Okay, so enter the session ID, I put in Holtz, join the session, still wants me to put in my first name, last name if I need to. Now it's going to say polling closed, of course. Now, when I open up the polling on a Turning Point Anywhere question that is not using any type of question list, of course, Responseware has no idea what the question is. So it's just listening as question and answer choice 1 through 10. All right, so that's the case where we're not using a question list, and we might be running this over top of another application, or we may just be asking the verbal questions. Now, as always, you could go ahead and send user feedback, and I can respond to it as a presenter by clicking the F11 key. So all those features are identically the same between Turning Point and Turning Point Anywhere. All right, you guys have any additional questions on using Responseware, setting it up from a student's perspective, anything further?
This still works if you set it up through Blackboard, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. So you could go ahead and do that as well. So if you set it up through Blackboard, it's going to be the same setup as if you're using those response cards. So really no difference whatsoever there. It basically, if you're using Responseware, it is a response card. It really is. You're just using a different type of median to answer the question. So you're still dealing with the same thing. Okay, anything additional in terms of Responseware? Or basically, guys, I'm going to open it up to anything else that we have covered in our training sessions.
Have you noticed any major differences between professors using Word 2010?
I tell you, if they're going to be using 2010, I would recommend they use Turning Point Anywhere. Still having a little bit of difficulty in terms of the integration with Turning Point in Office 10. So if they tell you that they are going to be using one of those newer Office versions, I would recommend that they use the Turning Point Anywhere software. The Turning Point Anywhere software, of course, does not get integrated with their PowerPoints. It runs in conjunction, so they're not going to have any trouble in terms of there being any interference with it. So we're still trying to work out the bugs on that. So if you do have professors on campus that tell you that they are using Office 10, Turning Point Anywhere would be 100% of the time, and that would be my suggestion for that. Okay. You guys got me on the line here, so if there's any other questions popping up from those instructors, professors, you know, please feel free to ask them now, or if you can't think of it right now, I mean, of course, I'm not going anywhere, so anytime you need to get in touch with me, you guys both have my email address, and you also have my direct contact number, so I'm always available as long as I'm not on the road, which we're starting to calm down a little bit in terms of on-site trainings, and as you guys can imagine, we cover every market, corporate, government, K-12, and higher education, so right around this time of the year, everybody wants an on-site training, so no excuse though for rescheduling with you guys a good handful of times, but I do appreciate the patience. But guys, before I let you go, are there any additional questions whatsoever on anything? Is there anything further happening on campus which I did not address?